Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is Dr. Muhammad Nazzal. I am the coordinator of Just CRS, which is a master's program that came out of a project co-funded by the Erasmus Plus program of the European Union. We are so happy to announce this webinar, which is number 6 in the series of webinars for Just CRS, yesterday, today, and tomorrow. We are happy to have Dr. Saddam Kanaan from Physical Therapy Program in the Department of Rehabilitation Sciences at Just University, Jordan University of Science and Technology. We are doing this webinar as part of Just CRS, but also in collaboration with Just Maharat Platform. Maharat Platform is a new electronic e-learning platform that is free for everybody. And we are using this platform to expand the knowledge and disseminate the knowledge of the CRS program. Thank you for attending again and enjoy the presentation. Fadal, Doctor.
Thank you, Dr. Muhammad, for the presentation. Good evening, all. As Dr. Muhammad said, so we will do the webinar presentation first, and then after hour and a half, we will open room for questions. My suggestion is you just can, as Dr. Muhammad said, you just can write your question in the chat area, and at the end, we just can answer all these questions. So today, our webinar is about neck pain assessment and treatment. And we are looking for the evidence-based approach. Okay, so my name is Saddam Kanaan. I'm assistant professor of physical therapy at the Department of Rehabilitation Science at Faculty of Applied Medical Sciences at Jordan University of Science and Technology. And again, I need to emphasize the thanking of all the partners. Okay, so the objective about this webinar, most of the webinar is about reviewing the American Physical Therapy Guidelines, which was established in 2017. And this guidelines consists of systematic reviews of many literature. It was extensive reviews of literature that include assessment and treatment for cervical spine. And they established a guidelines for treatment and assessment of neck pain. The most important about objective is to say this is a guidelines is not a standard of care. Okay, so this is not you need to apply this form to all patients. Okay, remember that every patient is different from other, and we work on patient-centered approach. So most of the guidelines will help you to guide you through the assessment and the treatment. And this should not be like a must for all patients. And one of the limitation of this guidelines, it reviewed article before 2016, and I included more recent articles for this webinar. So it will include the guidelines and some of the articles that newly published. So we'll talk about important aspect of assessment and the treatment. And again, this should be evidence-based approach. It's not depending on any clinical experience. So what we found, there is evidence about it. We'll talk about it in the this webinar. Hopefully, you'll find this webinar useful for you. Okay, so in this presentation, we'll talk about prevalence, risk factors, pathoanatomy, and in the assessment, we'll talk about self-reported outcome measures and physical impairment measures. We'll talk about them in general. And for treatment, we'll talk about the classification. We'll talk about neck pain with mobility deficits, neck pain with coordination impairment, and cervicogenic headache and cervicalgia. As introduction, prevalence of neck pain. Prevalence of neck pain is not as common as low back pain. It is estimated that 22 to 70% of the population will have neck pain sometime in their lifetime. So most of the population will have neck pain in a certain period in their life. At any given time, if you screen the population, you will find 10 to 20% of the population right now, they have neck pain. Literature worldwide found that the neck pain increases when the age increase, and most common in the women around the fifth decade of life. There is a survey in 2004 by Cott et al. Demonstrated that 37% of individuals who experience neck pain will report persistent problem for at least 12 months. And I think this is one of the major areas need to pay attention as physical therapists. Our treatment should be directed not only to treat the neck pain, it should be directed to prevent the recurrency of the neck pain. And this is very important. We see patients, we treated them for 3 to 4 sessions, and they are doing fine. After 3 to 4 months, or say 10 months, they will come back again to us. The most important aspect about the treatment is to prevent recurrency and chronic neck pain. So this is like 37% of the population who will have neck pain, like say 63% their neck pain will resolve, but 370% will have the neck pain. And usually those patients who visit us at our physiotherapy clinics. Okay, this is the risk factor of onset. Who is the risk group? Who will develop neck pain more than other people? And this is depend on the systematic review with high quality studies, 2012. They found female gender always at high risk to develop neck pain. And if you have one time neck pain, there is a higher chance to develop neck pain again. And this is important message to tell our patient. Okay, your neck pain is doing good, but you need to be careful. This neck pain will happen again. So I teach you exercise, I give you instructions, you should stick on them. It's sometimes wise for patient to visit us like once monthly or once every 2 months for assessment and for instruction and education again, because they will have higher chance to develop neck pain again. So again, female genders, previous history of neck pain, they were the strongest predictor of development of neck pain. Again, older age is a factor. High job demands, especially if we are talking about office work and other work that require abnormal posture of our cervical spine. Smokers are at higher chance to develop neck pain. If there is low social and work support, okay, so those people are at higher risk. And interestingly, if the patient have a history of low back pain, they will have a higher chance to develop cervical spine pain. We always see those patients who have this, what we call the combo. They have back pain and they have cervical spine pain. Most of the time, this is due to the bad postures and lack of exercise and the way of life for our health lifestyle for those patients. This is why low back pain and cervical pain are associated most of the time. It's around like 40% of the population we see them with cervical spine, they will have low back pain. About the prognosis, sometimes working with patients with cervical pain sometimes is quite not encouraging, actually. We do our best as physical therapists, and we don't see that favorable outcomes. There is huge variation, okay? And not all patients with cervical spine, we can treat them fully, and they can be fully recovered. And this is actually important information for us. As physical therapists, sometimes we feel bad. We are not doing our best. For our current knowledge, our current science, our current clinical skills, they didn't reach the level that we can treat all patients perfectly with their neck pain. So some deficits, some problems will persist. Okay. Okay. As physical therapists, we are required to improve ourselves, to improve our skills, to improve our knowledge. Okay. But even with all the measures that you do to improve your skills, there's some problem will still stay in that patient. Looking for whiplash, okay, regardless the outcome measures that we use, so whether it was pain, disability, recovery appears to occur most rapidly in the first 6 to 12 weeks post-injury. So we know whiplash, so this is neck pain that usually accompanied by trauma. So most of the outcomes, most of the improvement, we'll see them in the first 6 to 12 weeks. There will be considerable slowing after that. The outcomes will be very slow and not a huge improvement. And it's sometimes very difficult to see any recovery after 12 months. So most important, whiplash and most of the cervical spine, we need to have early intervention because most of the improvement will happen in the first month and month and a half. And after that, the improvement will be delayed. And this is sometimes this is a message we can deliver to the physician that we work with. They need to refer the patient as soon as possible to physical therapy department. Non-specific neck pain, 47% of improvement within 6 months. We can see the improvement, which is a little bit higher than the whiplash. Cervical myelopathy, this is where the cervical pain accompanied by compression on the spinal cord. As physical therapists, we consider this as red flag. When we discover that our patient might have myelopathy, we need to refer them for physician to have opinion about the surgery. Why we consider this as a red flag? Because 18% only show progressive functional improvement and 67 show progressive deterioration. So we can say most of the patients, they need surgical intervention. They will not benefit from physical therapy intervention. It will happen that some of the patients, okay, they might show some progress, okay? And some physician, they might refer patients to cervical myelopathy to physical therapy department. Because some of the patients, they refuse to have surgery, they deny surgery, they are not willing to try the surgery, they have comorbidities. We need to be honest with our patient, tell them about the prognosis, okay? Their improvement and outcomes will not be favorable. Okay, so only 18% of this population, they might benefit. So this is why those cohort of patients, they might benefit more from surgical than conservative. Most of the other cases, they can benefit from conservative management. Okay, but for this cervical myelopathy, we will consider this as a red flag and need surgical intervention more than conservative or physical therapy intervention. Radiculopathy, little is known. There is no enough research telling about the prognosis of this patient with radiculopathy because of the variation in this patient and between these studies. Patho-anatomical features. We need to know what are the structure that causing pain. So we need to know that different structure in our cervical spine, they may be the source of the pain. Like facet joints, okay, these joints can be the source of the pain. Vertebra itself can be the source of the pain. Muscles, ligaments, neural structure, and the intervertebral disc itself, it might hurt. We might feel pain because of the degeneration and the pressure on the cervical disc itself. Often the painful structure cannot be identified in diagnostic imaging. We cannot, as physical therapists or people who work in rehabilitation sciences, we don't work with the impairment. We work with disability, we work with patient signs and symptoms. We might benefit from reading the MRI report, seeing the MRI pictures from other medical imaging, but you just need to know that not all the findings in the MRI is related to the patient signs and symptoms. Maybe the patient have a disc, but he's complaining from facet joint pain. So MRI show you where is the degeneration or where it is the pathological area, but doesn't show you why the patient complained from that area of pain. This is very important information that even with the MRI finding, whatever was the findings, we need to examine our patient to identify what are the possible structure that can cause the pain for that patient. With identified impaired structure, there's a need to identify impaired muscle function, connective, and the neural tissue. So we need to examine our patient by physical examination. And this is, as physical therapists, we need to know how important is our physical examination in identifying signs or symptoms and to confirm other healthcare worker diagnosis. Okay, let's talk about examination. We need to talk about outcome measures. Okay, so it's all recommended in the guidelines that physical therapists, they should use valid and reliable outcome measures. We need to see valid means that they measure that what we need to measure, and reliable means if we examine patient one time, next time will give us the same results. It's useful to identify patient baseline status, pain, and functional disability. So we need to monitor patient symptoms from session to session. And To monitor patient size of symptoms, we cannot rely on the subjective narration of the patient. It's not enough to ask the patient, how are you improved from session to session? We need to have standardized, valid, reliable measure so we can tell there's improvement, there's deterioration, the situation is still the same. Monitoring changes in patient status through the course of the treatment, and all these outcome measures should be used as evaluation for evaluation of the patient. Okay, and then we can reach the diagnosis, and then we tell the patient about the prognosis. Okay, so these all outcome measures are important. Let's say about self-reported outcome measures that we rarely use, but this showed to be very useful. There are about like 20 outcome measures might be used to report outcome measures in neck pain. But the most commonly, and this is about reviewing of the literature, neck pain and neck disability index showed to be one of the most commonly used and one of the most valid and reliable questionnaire to be used in reporting dysfunction related to neck pain. It is patient completed, condition specific, functional status questionnaire. So the patient can complete this questionnaire by himself or herself. It's a specific function for the cervical spine. Okay, we can use other non-specific, but since this is related to the neck pain, so it will include items like personal care, lifting, reading, headaches, concentration, work, driving, sleeping, and recreation. And these all activities might be impaired or affected by neck pain. And it shows to be have high had adequate reliability, and is valid because it is condition specific. MDC means minimum detectable changes. So usually the score of the neck disability measure in 100 out of 100, how much is a disability for that patient. Any change around 14% that questionnaire considers significant important means there is a significant or important change that happened to that patient. If there's just 14% changes in these outcome measures. Other questionnaire self-reported that can be used, it is the patient-specific functional scale. As very quick, patient-specific functional scale talk about specific function that is important for that patient, okay? And why this is some therapists like it, because it's focused on patient-centered approach. So what is the most important function for that patient? And they measure the changes in this particular function. And this can be used in multiple musculoskeletal condition. SF-36 is one of the most common questionnaire used in healthcare profession, actually. SF-36 is about quality of life. It is patient-reported survey of patient health. This is was translated to many languages. It's available in Arabic language. It was validated as valid and reliable for most of the musculoskeletal and non-musculoskeletal condition. And one of the good things about SF-36, talking about the quality of life, it's more than disability. It's talking about social life, psychological function, mental function. So it measures about our functioning, particularly about the physical component and mental component, and we can combine this questionnaire to have a total quality of life. And the last one we need to talk about is the pain. Okay, so measuring the pain intensity, how intense is the pain from 0 to 10 using pain numeric pain rating scale. We need to measure the quality of pain. What is the pain quality, like aching, pins and needles, numbness, all these quality can be a very important element for the diagnosis. And we need to report the bodily distribution. Where is the area of the pain? And we can report this on the body chart. And we need to talk about temporal features of the pain. Ask the patient how the pain fluctuates with activity and rest. So we need to see about exacerbation and remission factors. What are the factors that can increase the pain? Like gait, sitting, standing, sleeping. And how is the pain changing over the day? When you wake up, during the day, in your work, after the work, in the night, and during the sleep. We can look for pain referral button. This is when we talk about the pain location. It's important to look for the distribution of the pain. This is one, actually this is a very old study, but show very interesting findings. Show when we have a facet joint. So basically in this study, they injected the facet joint and increased the pressure inside the facet joint. And the patients start to complain from certain area of pain. So when they injected the C2, C3, the pain was, as you can see, in this area. C3, C4 is the lateral side of the neck. And actually you can see some patients, they might just tell you, I just have pain in this area. And some patients, they just can refer to the pain in all this area. And this is, might be related to C4, C5 cervical disc. And C5, C6. And C6, C7, they can, the pain can be referred as to this area. And this is a study from discogram. This show where is the pain from disc. So C2, C3, okay, this is picture number one. You can see where is the referral area. And C3, C4, okay, you can see where is the area of the pain. And when the patient report you to the area of the pain, you just can relate where is, might be the affected disc or the affected facet joint. So area of the pain in the body chart might be a vital tool for diagnosis. Okay, talking about physical impairment, we are moving from self-reported outcome measure to physical impairment measures. So the most common that we learn in our schools is a standard range of motion. Standard range of motion, cervical range of motion device, standard goniometer and inclinometer, most commonly used tools to measure cervical range of motion. It's a valuable tool in screening and diagnosis of cervicogenic headache and cervical radiculopathy. We'll see sometimes the limitation in the range of motion will tell us about the diagnosis. So basically, active range of motion, passive range of motion, still very simple, but still a key in our physical impairment measure. And clinicians should look for patterns between patient-reported and physical examination finding that rule in or rule out particular diagnostic classification for a patient. One of the most important things we talk about the physical impairment is to look for what we call comparable sign. Comparable sign means any movement or any test that can reproduce the pain that patient complain from. And we always need to develop a connection between what is the patient saying and what is the physical examination finding, okay? So that we can rule in and rule out a particular diagnostic classification. Okay, Sperling test. As you know, Sperling test is a test that we use mainly to differentiate between cervical pain with neurological problems like compression in the nerve root and cervical pain without compression in the neural structure. And actually this is a determining examination, very important examination. Most of the cases we are not sure what is the patient complaining from. Is the patient complaining from radiculopathy, means there's compression in the nerve root, there is a problem with the neural structures, or just a facet joint, there's limitation in the range of motion, there's degeneration in the joint, and this is will change or shift our treatment to other area. So one of the most important tests that we usually do is Sperling test. Cervical traction test, okay, so Sperling test is simply, we need to compress cervical spine in a neutral position first. Okay, the positive finding will be a reproduction of the signs and symptoms in the upper extremity, like pins and needles, numbness, tingling, etc. And there is a modification of this test. As if you are interested to see the modification or how you increase the degree of the Sperling test, you can revise Angstein 2018. Okay, this is a newly released study. So we start in the neutral position, then we go with the extension, and then we can combine extension, side bending, and rotation of the spine. Okay, as you can see in the picture, might be the reproduction will be on this side. So starting with the neutral, side bending, extension, and we can combine extension and rotation just to put more force on the nerve root so we can reproduce the pain if the pain was present. Okay, so if the spinning test was positive, means there is a neurological component. If it was negative, that doesn't mean, that means there is no neurological component with this cervical case. Cervical traction test, okay, or it's called traction distraction test. Simply the patient will lie supine and the patient do traction. And during the traction, if the pain in the upper extremity disappeared, means there's a neurological component on this patient. Sensitivity is 44% and specificity ranging from 90 to 97%. Sensitivity means if we examine 100% with neck pain with cervical radiculopathy or compression in the nerve root, we know for sure they have a cervical or nerve root problem. 44 will be positive in that test, and this is very little. But the most important about cervical traction test is if we have patient that we are sure there is no problem with cervical radiculopathy, the test will be negative on 90 to 97 people on that test. Okay, and one thing we need to think about, Spelling test might be have some limitation in the sensitivity and specificity. As here you can see, there's a limitation here. In fact, we don't have the best test ever. Okay, most of the physical examination tests, even the diagnostic imaging, they have not full sensitivity and specificity. And this is why we're shifting our practice now from doing one single test to doing what we call the cluster. And today in this lecture, we'll talk about the cluster that we use to diagnose patients using multiple tests. And upper limb neural tension test, you know, called neurodynamic examination, and this is a big school, but for examination, one of the mostly commonly examined in the literature was upper limb neural tension test. Okay, this is where what we call median nerve bias. And still now, they found it's very important examination to diagnose of cervical radiculopathy because of the sensitivity. 97% of the patient who have cervical radiculopathy will be positive on that test. 3 will be negative, so it has higher sensitivity. But the problem, not in sensitivity, but in specificity. Only 22% of the patient who doesn't have cervical radiculopathy will be negative on the test. So this is why if you do the test, even in the normal population, they most of the time they are positive. Upper cervical instability test. These are tests are very important to see if there is any instability. Instability mostly occurred in the cervical spine due to trauma, okay, like whiplash, okay? And this will cause movement coordination. When the patient have a trauma, most of the time, we do upper cervical instability test to make sure there's no injury in the LR and transverse ligament. And this is key component. Like if I have any patient with history of trauma, or they come with neck pain due to trauma, one of the first things to do as examination, we need to do the LR and transverse ligament instability test, one of the key components. So this is preliminary even for premanipulative testing and diagnosis of upper cervical instability. And before we are trying to do any manipulation, this is preliminary assessment. So we need to make sure they don't have any instability. Instability, as we said, would happen due to trauma, but it can be caused by other syndromes like rheumatoid arthritis, Down syndrome, etc. Okay, and it's considered part of the red flag assessment. So if the patient have significant LR transverse ligament, they might be referred to the physician. So if you have any patient with a trauma, they were clear on the cervical X-ray and the physician didn't find any fractures, any significant red flags, they might refer this patient to us as physical therapists. But very important examination we need to do for this patient is red flag assessment, including LR ligament and transverse ligament test. Studies show that specificity has been studied in many studies, but there are variability in sensitivity testing. Okay, specificity for this cervical instability test adequate. Okay. but there's a huge variation in the sensitivity of these tests. What is the most important information about this? You don't depend highly on the result of these tests. Okay, they might tell you there might be a problem or there might not be a problem. Okay, but you cannot say 100%, I'm sure there's no instability test. We need to add more measures here. Okay, we will talk about the movement coordination problem, about some other tests that we can use just to make sure those patients, they don't have any kind of instability in their cervical spine. One of the tests that we can use is called Algometric Assessment of Pressure Pain Threshold. Okay, this tool has been validated to be used in physical therapy clinics and in many research, and has shown test reliability about 83%, which is quite good, and might be helpful to identify trigger points or to measure the pain, because numeric pain rating scale is subjective. Okay, and as physical therapists, we suffer for a long period of time by having this subjective examination. And now we can have this tool that we can do objective examination and can be used to monitor the patient changes every time during the clinic. And this is dependent on the intensity of the pressure that you can insert by this device until the patient starts to feel the pain. So if there's irritability or severe pain, the amount of pressure will be very low. If we can insert this document down more with more pressure and the patient start to feel the pain only on the high pressure, that can tell you the pain is improved. Okay, so this is tool can be used as objective assessment for pain in cervical spine and other musculoskeletal condition. Still, observation very important for our examination. We need to assess the posture. We need, again, even with talking about the evidence-based practice, still we need to correlate the patient signs and symptoms, patient posture to their physical examination findings. Forward posture is a very common problem for multiple cervical condition like neck pain with mobility deficits, cervicogenic headache, and cervical radiculopathy. As you can see, the most people, they are sitting in forwarded posture due to use of the laptops, due to the office work, due to our health style nowadays. It can cause numerous musculoskeletal and neurovascular impairment. It can cause by muscle imbalance. Okay, and the muscle imbalance will cause deformation and pressure on our disc, our facets, our ligaments, and this is why they cause different type of pain. Most of the patients can be presented by rounded scapular or shoulder, aphotic thoracic spine, and there will be extension in the upper cervical spine and flexion in the lower cervical spine. And one of the things that we talk about the exercise, we need to develop exercise that can match these abnormal findings. Okay, one of the most important trend in physical therapy now, we do classification. Why classification? Because I think as physical therapists, we tried many schools in our management of cervical spine and even for our low back pain patient. And we find some of the techniques that work for some patient that doesn't work for other people. And this trend has been going until recently. Most of the physiotherapists and scientists in physical therapy, they start to develop what we call the clusters, or we develop what we call the clinical prediction rules. Depending on the study, like Fritz and Brennan, 2007, they found that the treatment matched for certain group of neck pain patients showed to have better outcomes in comparison to non-matched treatment. So what we start to do now for cervical and for low back pain, we start to classify the patient to major conditions or major categories, and we design treatment plan for each category. So as example, patient with cervicogenic headache, their treatment and different techniques will work differently if we are working with a patient with neck pain with mobility deficits. According to the APTA guidelines, and depends on many literature, they decided to break down the neck pain to four major classification. And this is very important and very useful in clinical practice. I really recommend this way of treating the patient. you will see there will be a difference in the outcomes of your patient. So the major classification will be neck pain with mobility deficits. Okay, and I will talk about each of the category later on, how what is the most important physical finding, what will be the cluster of examination we can do for those patients. Neck pain with mobility deficits. Okay, so a patient who have just limitation in the range of motion and pain during range of motion. They don't have any neurological symptoms. Other category, which is the whiplash, or any neck pain happened due to trauma. And the most important problem with the trauma is the instability and movement coordination impairment. So they have a problem in muscle strength, they have problem in the muscle endurance, they have proper reception problems and the control of their neck movement. And the third category, it is neck pain with headaches, what we call cervicogenic headache. So this can be a different category and it might need some different treatment techniques than other treatment. And the last one, and maybe this is the most common one that we see in our clinics, is neck pain with radiating pain, or what we call the radicular or cervical radiculopathy. So this is basically the neck pain that accompanied by compression in the neural structure, mostly the nerve root. Okay, so this is what was suggested as a guidelines, okay, how we can classify those patients. So the first thing we need to determine that this patient is appropriate for physical therapy evaluation or treatment. Means we need to exclude first the red flags. If we found those patients, they have cervical myelopathy, they have fracture, they might have malignancy, okay, we need to refer this patient to the physician or other healthcare providers. So the basic step that we do before doing anything to the patient, we need to exclude what we call red flags. Second category here is appropriate for physical therapy evaluation and intervention, along with the consultation with another healthcare providers. So some patient, they might benefit from physical therapy, but they need other healthcare providers. As some patient, they might have psychological problems. Some patient, they might have psychosocial problems. And this might be a message for our colleagues in occupational therapy. So they might be an asset in some of the conditions, especially patients with having higher psychological factors. And some patients, they might need to have other healthcare providers like pain management. So the first one, not appropriate for physical therapy evaluation. We need to have consultation with appropriate healthcare provider. Okay. Other category, they might benefit from physical therapy, but need another healthcare consultation. And the third category, they are appropriate for physical therapy evaluation and intervention. So this is the whole case can be treated by physical therapy. Basically, we can say this is a mechanical condition, mostly. And after we determine who's appropriate for physical therapy, we need to classify those patients to these four categories. As we said, neck pain with radiating pain, neck pain with headache, neck pain with movement coordination impairment, and neck pain with mobility deficits. So, and we can talk about in the next slides about how to classify those patients. Okay, first thing, as we said, we need to see the red flags. Okay, the most important red flags are fractures. So we need to ask about history of trauma, constant pain with movement, and if there's any X-ray findings reported by the physician. Metastasis might be one. More than one of these four factors can be a predictor of patient having carcinogenic cell or metastasis, like having night pain, especially the consistent one, unexplained rapid weight loss, history of cancer, and higher age. Okay, so if the patient have like more than one, okay, if the patient have a higher age, that doesn't mean he might have metastasis. But if the patient have 2 out of 4, they have higher chance of having metastasis. If the patient have 3 out of 4, they might have a very high chance. If the 4, like we can say, there's a strong opportunity that the patient will have metastasis or carcinogenic cells. We need to look for vertebrobasilar insufficiency and the 5 T's, dizziness, diplopia, drop attacks, dysphagia, and dysarthria. This can be a predictor of insufficiency in the vertebral artery and they can predict transient ischemic attack. And we need to always check about these signs and symptoms. As we said, the first important factor when we treat the patient or start the examination, we need to exclude red flags. And we need to look about these signs and symptoms. Cervical myelopathy, this is one of the most common red flags that we face as physical therapists. Cervical myelopathy, as you can see in the MRI, there's a compression of the spinal cord. Okay, and if there is some, as we said, like around more than 65% of the population, they will have progressive functional deficits and they will end up with the need for surgery because there might be spinal cord injury in these cases. So this is most common non-traumatic cause of spinal cord injury. So this is a red flag, very important problem. MRI is usually the golden standard for diagnosis. Okay, so this is why it's sometimes important to have medical diagnosis first. And if we are working on the direct access, means that the physical therapist see the patient first, okay, they need to know how to differentiate between possibility of having cervical myelopathy or not. So Cook et al. 2010, they suggest 5 examination that can tell us if there is a possibility of having cervical myelopathy. As you can see, a new trend in physical therapy start to work in clusters. We are not doing only one test because of the low sensitivity and low specificity of the physical examination. So we need to have more than one examination. And based on this cluster, we start to diagnose those patients. So this is just like 5 elements. If there is the patient have gait deviation, like wide-based gait, ataxia, or spastic gait. If the patient have positive Hoffman sign, okay, as you can see, looking for the sensitivity is 590% and specificity for 49%. This is very low. So this is why we can't depend on one of these tests alone. Inverted supinator sign, sensitivity 61%, specificity 78%. Positive Babinski sign, and age more than 45. So we have these 5 tests and elements. If there's just one positive, we said the likelihood ratio is minus 0.18. We need to rule out. So if we have like positive Babinski sign and all these tests were negative, we can say with high probability there is no problem in the myelopathy. The patient doesn't have myelopathy. If the patient has 3 or more, there is a strong likelihood ratio that the patient, they have myelopathy. So if you have like patient with gait deviation, inverted supinator sign, if they were more than 45, okay, these were positive, negative Babinski sign, negative inverted supinator sign, there's a huge, a high probability that those patients, they have myelopathy. There's only one positive, there's a huge high probability that the patient doesn't have this myelopathy problem. Okay, so this is why working on the clusters is very important, because as physical therapists, we know we face many times during our physical examination that this is positive and the patient doesn't have a problem. This is negative and the patient has a problem. We are always being confused. Now the trend is being shifting toward myelopathy, toward clustering of many physical examination findings. And based on these clusters, we can provide the diagnosis. Okay, so again, this is important just to say the red flags. Yellow flags. And most of the recent literature looking for the importance of the yellow flags. How important are the yellow flags in our assessment and treatment of general musculoskeletal condition? Many literature show that anxiety, depression, fear avoidance, catastrophization, all these elements play an important role in developing recurrent and chronic pain in general, not about cervical spine. So assessing yellow flags can tell us sometimes why the prognosis is poor, why the patient having this kind of pain, why the patient, the pain came to be chronic, not only acute, because of the yellow flags. Looking about psychological factors, looking about social factors as well. These are very important elements. And looking for this, sometimes patients with significant yellow flags, okay, still we can work with them as physical therapists. but they might benefit from counseling of psychologists or psychiatrists. Okay, so this is to improve their outcomes. But still, they are different from red flags. We don't need to refer them to the physician for sure. They're still appropriate for our physical therapy, assessment, and intervention. And if you remember, we talked about here, appropriate for physical therapy evaluation and intervention, along with consultation with another healthcare provider. So as example of this category, patients with significant yellow flags. Okay, so no appropriate physical therapy evaluation and intervention, like cervical myelopathy. Okay, they are not proper for physical therapy. So yellow flags is very important aspect of our treatment. And this is can tell us that this is why we need to work as multidisciplinary team. We need to have other healthcare providers that we can collaborate to have better outcomes for patients with cervical spine. As you can see now in our country, most of the cervical spine, they are being the patients just only for physical therapists. But current research findings, current guidelines, they suggest it needs multidisciplinary approach. As physical therapists, we are not good in counseling. This is we are not educated to be a counselors. Okay, but we can use some measures that can help patients with yellow flags, like education, their knowledge about their condition, their knowledge about their exercise, their intervention. We need to assure the patient that sometimes this treatment needs some time. Just talk to your patient, explain to them the problem, explain them the treatment plan, explain them the pain pathophysiology, why they are feeling like this, why the pain is becoming recurrent. Sometimes you can't tell them it's okay, they can't move. It's okay, they can't go back to their life. So most of the education and talking to the patient is very important to address the yellow flags without being a counselor. Cognitive behavioral therapy, okay? We are not expertise in cognitive behavioral therapy, but we can use some of the principles as physical therapists. But most important, we can collaborate with other healthcare providers like occupational therapists. Might be very important for that patient progress. Okay, when we talked about the stages of the condition, okay, so during the treatment section in this webinar, we'll talk about acute, subacute, and chronic. And the definition of the acute, subacute, and chronic is a very controversial point. So nowadays, we don't depend on the time just to say this is acute. Okay, as you know, there's a huge variation in the literature about what is the acute cervical pain, what is subacute, and the chronic. So most of the people agree that up to 6 weeks, we can call it acute cervical pain. 6 to 12 weeks, subacute. And chronic, more than 12 weeks, about month and a half. Sorry, 3 months. Sorry, here, month and a half. All right? Sorry, 1 month and a half and 3 months. Okay? So depending on the time alone is not enough. Okay? Because we have, like as example, we have recurrent neck pain. Patient have neck pain since 6 months, and the next day they wake up with severe pain. We cannot say this is chronic, because in this case, we call it acute. Depending on the time, this should be chronic, okay? But as a classification for treatment, it's hard to say this is a chronic, it's acute, okay? This is why we need to have other measures to define the stages of the condition. The second measure is irritability. If the patient have higher irritability, means the pain will be very severe, like 8 out of 10, 9 out of 10. And the patient will have increased the pain while doing small activity, like just turning 15 degrees of rotation, they will have pain. If the patient sit on the computer for 5 minutes, they will have severe pain. Okay, this means those patients are very irritable, and we can classify them even without looking to the time as acute, because they are highly irritable. Patients with moderate irritability, as example, when they sit down on the computer, they will feel pain after half an hour. We'll say this is moderately irritable. Patient with minimum irritability, whatever was the timing, we can say that those patients are chronic. Okay, and depending on the range of motion. So simply, if there is pain at the beginning of the range of motion, Okay, we can say this patient is acute. Okay, as we know, the common condition, what we call dry neck, when you wake up and you find your neck is stuck, with any small movement, it's very painful. This is acute. Okay, so the pain at the beginning of the range, it's from initial to mid-range spinal movement. If the pain started from the mid-range and that worsened with the end range, okay, this is what we call subacute. And the pain here is at the end or with overpressure, we can't call it. Okay, so to define the stage of the condition is not enough. Okay, a single time is good. Okay, it can give us a hint. Okay, but to have proper staging of the condition, we need to look for the irritability and the range of motion. And this is how this guidelines was developed, according to these three factors. So before, to assess the stage of the condition, we need to look for the time, for the irritability, and the range of motion. Okay, let's start with the first category, sneak pain with mobility deficits. In pathology, we say this is cases of acute and chronic facet joints. Cases of degenerative disease like spondylosis, like mean neck osteoarthritis, we can say. So these patients, they will develop neck pain with mobility deficits. So they have pain during their range of motion. Again, to say that the patient have neck pain with mobility deficits, I need to exclude patient with radiculopathy. I need to exclude patient with trauma because they might have whiplash. I need to exclude patient with cervicogenic headache. Okay, like doing neck pain, first I'm doing like sparing tests and other tests to make sure the patient doesn't have radiculopathy. So what are the symptoms? Symptoms are central and or unilateral neck pain, okay? So most of the therapists say facet joints or neck pain with mobility deficits usually, mostly or most of the time are unilateral. It can be central. There's limitation in the neck motion that consistently reproduces the symptoms. So this is mechanical. When we move the neck, okay, they will reproduce the symptoms. It might be there's referral, okay, the shoulder girdle or upper extremity pain might be present. Okay, so what are the physical examination we can use here? Neck pain reproduce at end range of active and passive motion, like passive range of motion, active range of motion, or active range of motion with overpressure. So range of motion examination is very important. We need to do passive physiological intervertebral movement, PIVMs, okay, starting with general physiological movement, and then we can do passive physiological movement. Although this type of examination showed to be poor to fair inter-examiner reliability. So if you are doing the test, this session and next session might be the findings can be different because there is huge variation. Sometimes it's very poor reliability. We cannot depend on it too much. This is why we can use it as part of the sequence of examination. We need to include the active, then the passive, and then we need to include the intersegmental mobility, which is the passive accessory intervertebral movement that we use as mobilization, okay? So we need to mobilize each segment to make sure where is the painful or to reproduce the symptoms or what we call comparable sign. Neck and referred pain reproduced with provocation of the involved cervical or upper thoracic segments or cervical musculature. One important thing to talk about the cervical is to relate the cervical with thoracic. As they are highly correlated. They are very important aspects. Even now, some of the therapists, when they talk about the cervical spine, we talk about cervical thoracic spine problems. Deficits, okay, due to the limitation in the range of motion, due to the limitation in the mobility, we can expect there's decrease in the strength and motor control might be present with subacute and chronic pain. Characteristics of the subacute and the chronic pain, there is weakness. And knowing about this, we need to include important aspects, which is strengthening and sometimes endurance and maybe neck movement control exercises. Interestingly, in the chronic stage, we can see there's a proprioception impairment. Okay, and we can test this proprioception. As one example, we can ask the patient to close his eyes or her eyes and move her neck to the side and then bring it back to the neutral. and just kind of look to the patient. When they close the eyes, they can go to the neutral. That means they have good proper reception. If they were not able to go back to the neutral stage, they might have problem with the proper reception. And just can examine this interestingly in your patient. And talking about proper reception, very important aspect is to do proper reception training, to train the patient in front of the mirror, what is the proper position of the neck. Because as we said before, most of the problem is related to the from the bad posture. So what are the suggested treatment for patient with mobility deficits? As you can see, there is a grading. What do you mean by grading? Grade A and B and C, and there might be other grades. So I just included the grade if it was A or B and C. Grade E, it was a recommendation based on different systematic reviews, multiple systematic reviews. So systematic reviews, these are literature that use different articles, like different randomized control trial, and they find the general conclusion about this randomized control trial. So grade A means more than one high quality randomized systematic reviews, one was included to suggest this treatment. Grade B, there might be one or low quality systematic reviews. Grade C, maybe there's lower evidence. So grade B means there's strong, grade A means there's very strong evidence to suggest that the treatment. Grade B, there is lower evidence, but still very good, okay? Grade C means there's good suggestion from scientific evidence to suggest that the treatment. So one of the most important treatment that we can use to treat patient during the acute stage is thoracic manipulation, okay? Which is this consistent, what we see, thoracic manipulation is very popular now because many studies, actually can see many literatures, talk about the importance of thoracic manipulation in the improvement of neck pain. The mechanism is not that clear, but the most important about thoracic manipulation is you can connect the forward posture to the cervical posture. If you have severe kyphosis, for sure you'll have neck pain. If there's limitation in the thoracic movement, you will have more pressure and more pain in the cervical spine. If you manipulate the thoracic spine, there will be sudden improvement even in the neck pain because of the sudden relaxation of the muscle spasm around the cervical and the thoracic area. This will improve the cervical pain. So one of the conditions like what we have right neck, the pain that we usually find during wake up in the morning, we have severe neck pain. So thoracic manipulation, especially if you are doing upper thoracic manipulation, will be very helpful to decrease the amount of pain. Cervical range of motion, stretching and isometric strengthening exercise can be useful in the acute stage, okay? In the acute stage, the most common recommendation is to stay active, plus home cervical range of motion and isometric exercise. And one of the bad things that we see in the clinics, especially from general practitioners, they recommend the patient to wear cervical collars. Cervical collars, as you can see, is not recommended at all. Okay, there is no scientific evidence, so this is a useful practice for acute. Instead, the patient, they can move. If we're talking about cervical range of motion, we need to talk here about respecting the irritability level. Okay, so as pain-free range of motion, this is good. Stretching exercise without increasing the irritability is good. Isometric strengthening exercise still can be useful, but here you need to be aware of the irritability level for that patient, okay? So this should be a supervised exercise and we can teach patient, okay? So this is why here supervised exercise is important because you can't simply give the patient videos. They might do exercise in the bad way that might increase their pain. So here it's suggested that the patient, they will do supervised exercise. Cervical range of motion, stretching and isometric. So they can do it with you in the clinic. Other exercises that show how important is the cervicoscapulothoracic. Cervicoscapulothoracic. So some exercises are like thoracic extension, thoracic rotation, thoracic bending, okay, can be helpful in this stage. Scapular control, like the exercise I, T, W, and Y, Okay, an exercise that can stabilize the scapula and movement of the muscle around the scapula can help to decrease and resolve the problem in the acute stage. Other suggestion, okay, they need to stay active. If they stay in the bed, stay not moving, their condition will be worse. It's always suggested that the patient stay active even during the acute stage. This helps to prevent muscle atrophy. They help to decrease the catastrophization of the patient. They help to prevent fear avoidance on those patients. Usually these factors can usually bring the patient from acute stage and make them chronic neck pain. So if they can be active, this will decrease the chance from being chronic cervical pain. One of the things that we need to pay attention about is talking about the acute. The most important factor about the acute stage, as reported by literature, we don't need the patient to go to be a chronic patient. Okay, and when the patient have neck pain once, we don't need the patient to have neck pain again. So even if your treatment was not excellent to remove the pain, decrease the pain, but you need to make sure these strategies are important to decrease the pain, to prevent the recurrence of the pain, and to prevent development of chronic pain. Okay, so some patients, they might feel annoyed by being active. Okay, they prefer to rest. You just have to take the pills and just to have a rest. Some resting is okay, but resting all the day is not good. Suggested that the patient, they start to be active, active most of the day, but not doing aggressive work. Okay, they don't have to sit for hours and hours in the office. Okay, they just can do some work. They can walk, they can sit outside, they can play, they can use some ADLs and instrumental activity of the ADLs. Gretzky, cervical mobilization and manipulation. Okay, there's weak evidence that cervical mobilization and manipulation can be useful. Okay, so better to use thoracic manipulation than cervical mobilization and manipulation. All right. There's great C, there's weak evidence. It means the evidence is still not that solid, but still there shows some improvement. Okay, but we still prefer to use these measures. So to summarize, the acute stage where the patient only have neck pain with mobility deficits, you can do cervical manipulation, a pain-free range of motion exercise, very slight stretching, and isometric exercise for the cervical spine. We advise them to stay active, and we can start to do cervicoscapulothoracic exercise. We can teach them to do exercise in the thoracic spine, scapular control exercise, and we can, as we said, we can do some range of motion, stretching, and isometric. If you want to do more, cervical mobilization and manipulation can be a choice. Or doing mobilization, need to be very gentle because the pain can be huge, so we don't use more than a grade 1 and a grade 2. If we there is no evidence talking about the effect of Mulligan approach here, okay? If you want to try it, why not? But as evidence-based management, we recommend to use these measures better than other measures. And as you can see here, talking about grade, there is no effect for any measures that stabilize the cervical spine, like taping, as example, collar, is not all recommended. Okay, there is not in cervical manipulation. This issue has been going. Can we do cervical manipulation? Or do we need, from evidence-based practice, to do cervical manipulation? Looking for a very important systematic review in 2015, there is strong evidence support thoracic manipulation versus control of neck pain function and quality of life. So many literature showed that thoracic manipulation very useful across different stages and different classifications. So it's gonna be useful like in cervical radiculopathy as well. Result for cervical manipulation and mobilization versus control are few and diverse. So the evidence that suggests thoracic manipulation is stronger than the evidence that suggests cervical manipulation. And there is publication bias. Okay, some of the other authors, they have bias toward their findings when talk about cervical manipulation. Okay, manipulation and mobilization for cervical spine can provide similar results, okay, for most of the outcomes, including quality of life, including pain, including stability, functional disability. So basically, if you are doing mobilization, grade one, grade two, grade three, grade four, they will kind of give you some the same benefit as manipulation. So as physical therapist here, okay, with if you are not very skillful in manipulation, that should be okay. You can do the mobilization, all right. It's suggested you always do thoracic manipulation, cervical mobilization. For cervical manipulation, it's useful. It's documented to be useful with some bias, but still there is scientific evidence that suggests cervical manipulation can be useful. But there's one problem in the cervical manipulation. There's some risk included. Although the case is recorded, there is a serious harm for patients with cervical manipulation can reach between 1 to 3 out of 100,000 population. Okay, but still there is some kind of harm. This is why most of the physical therapists, based on scientific evidence, suggest the physical therapist can do thoracic manipulation, cervical mobilization. If they are confident the patient is fit for cervical manipulation, they can do the manipulation, all right? But as you can, if you are not skillful, or for myself, I don't do cervical manipulation for any kind of condition, okay? Because I always think about I might include some harm. Even if I'm doing preliminary as stability test, vertebral basilar artery insufficiency test, but still I'm not prefer, because I think if I'm doing mobilization, I can reach the same effectiveness as manipulation. I can do thoracic manipulation with safe and effective practice. Talking about subacute stage, cervical scapulothoracic endurance exercise. So here we need to focus on endurance, okay, not only strength. Okay, the patient can repeat it more. Okay, if we started with 10 repetitions, we can go for 20 and 30. We don't need to increase resistance here, we just need to increase the endurance. Because if you look for the patient, most of the time, pain is coming because of our low endurance. And always in this stage, we need to teach the patient home exercise program. So cervical, scapulothoracic, cervical range of motion, some isometric exercise, endurance exercise, scapular endurance exercise, thoracic endurance exercise, will be taught to be done at home, okay? So this is the only finding that can suggest, okay, during the subacute stage, okay? There is no recommendation for any manual therapy here in this stage. For a grade C evidence, thoracic manipulation is still important, and cervical mobilization and manipulation, okay? So basically, you still can do manual therapy here. Thoracic manipulation can be still a good choice. Cervical mobilization, okay, manipulation, if you are confident about your skill and the fitness of your patient, after doing a preliminary assessment, okay, you can still do manipulation. But one of the mistakes, okay, and what makes our physical therapy pay better, as you can see, this is can be the work of other healthcare providers like chiropractors, okay? They are just doing manipulation, but our important work as physical therapists, we are the best healthcare providers that can provide exercise. So the clinical evidence or scientific evidence support our work as physical therapists. We are having the best tools, which is our exercise. Secondary, we can have the manual therapy. Working with manual therapy is very weak. Working with exercise is very strong. So sometimes as physical therapists, we know how to do this exercise, okay? But we think this is not fancy tools as manipulation. No, it's very fancy, very important, very useful in the short term and long term, okay? About chronic stage, okay, again, we still have the manual therapy tools, thoracic manipulation, cervical manipulation or mobilization, and we can use mixed exercise and supervised exercise, okay? Means by mixed exercise, sorry, we can do coordination, proprioception, postural training, stretching, strengthening, endurance training, aerobic condition, and cognitive affective element. Okay, especially here, there's a highlight about the importance of cognitive behavioral therapy, about the education, about the assurance, about the psychosocial factors, because most of the chronic condition, they have psychosocial element. Okay, so I need to pay attention that patient, they might bear some psychosocial element, and this is manifested in their pain and their functional disability. Again, exercise is very important. thoracic manipulation still very important. Cervical manipulation is very important. And again, the exercise is not only for the neck. Should we include the thoracic? They should include. We should include the scapular control exercises. Grade C, psychological counseling and continue life after lifestyle. Why there's a grade C evidence? Because I don't think for psychological counseling, there's no much research about it, actually. This is becoming a new trend. So in the future, in the next 2 years, you'll see more articles talking about the psychological counseling, cognitive behavioral therapy, and other psychological factors, and they're important in the management of chronic pain, especially in the cervical condition. But still, education, assurance for the patient, decrease their fear. Okay, this is going to be important factor in their management. Okay, so as physical therapists, I think, and scientific evidence think, the most important tool we can provide for our patient is education. Don't spend too much time in doing non-useful techniques. Spend more time talking to your patient. Talk about their problems. Talk about their conditions. Talk about their prognosis. These very, very important tools. Second category is neck pain with movement coordination impairment. Simply, we say patient with a trauma, we can move them toward whiplash. Okay, so usually this is linked to any case related to trauma, especially the whiplash. About symptoms, it might include different symptoms, and sometimes it's accompanied by concussion. And there is dizziness, nausea, problem with memory, hypersensitivity, thermal, acoustic, odor, and light stimuli, heightened affective distress. In talking about whiplash, there are many factors can be associated with. And this is why you need to have multidisciplinary. So they need to have a neurologist, orthopedist, we need to have occupational therapist, we need to have physical therapist. As physical therapist, after clearing from medical diagnosis, we need to make sure or to assess the stability issues. We talked about ulnar and transverse ligament and other instability tests for the cervical spine. And we said the sensitivity and specificity is not that strong. Other elements that we can use for assessment is what we call the cranial cervical flexion test. This is about the endurance, how the patient can do flexion and stay in that position for a period of time. There is neck flexor muscle endurance and there is neck extensor endurance. Okay, so most of the time we do manual muscle testing for cervical spine. And recent evidence findings show that we need to do more endurance testing. And neck pain impairment may include altered muscle activation pattern, proprioception deficits, postural balance or control. It's not only about strength. There is endurance is important and there's proprioception is important. Okay, and we need to have proprioception training for those patients. As most of the exercises that you can do in front of the mirror, teach the patient how to locate their neck in the right posture, how to adjust their body to the right posture. Because of the injury in the whiplash might include different structure that might have proprioception and very important for proprioception. So after the injury, there will be proprioception problems. Cranial cervical flexion test. Okay, this has become an important test for understanding the symptoms of the patient with whiplash problems. Again, we will end up here, in 10 to 15 minutes. So please make sure to write your questions in the chat. Positive neck flexor muscle endurance test. And there is positive pressure ergometry. So we can use the algometer to see the pain. And usually the algometer here, during this case, we can use it in the upper trapezius. So the change in the upper trapezius can reflect the improvement or deterioration in the patient case. Okay, you can see different area of trigger maps, trigger points maps that be associated with the whiplash and where we can use the algometer. Differential diagnosis. As we said, sensitivity can be varied. There is adequate specificity, and there is the need for more research to show how accurate this ligament is. This is why it's important to examine the endurance and to examine the proprioception for those patients. Acute stage. Education is very important. As you can see, for whiplash, education always important. Okay, you need to talk to the patient about their problems, what happened to them, what is the possible prognosis. You can tell them, okay, most of the recovery will occur in the 2 to 3 months, so they will not have immediate improvement in their symptoms. Okay, they need to wait. Okay, and this is the normal prognosis, the normal consequences of this injury. Okay, some patients, they might feel stressed, they feel anxiety because their situation doesn't improve very quick. Okay, they need to be assured, okay, there will be improvement, but you just need to be patient. Okay, the most important, the grade B recommendation is education, advice to remain active, act as usual. Okay, they need to minimize use of cervical collar. Okay, so this is the only way, the only category that you can see a suggestion for using the collar. And the suggestion is to minimize use. Okay, they cannot use it too much or for a longer period of time. You will see many acute stage of whiplash, the patient wear the collar 24 hours. Okay, this is not recommended by scientific evidence. So they need to minimize it as much as they can. Okay, they need to remain active. They need to act as usual as they can. They need to do postural and mobility exercise. And the most important, they need to be educated. They need reassurance. We can use mixed type of exercise, cervical, scapulothoracic. And again, when we talk about acute stage, look for irritability level. And as a grade C recommendation, okay, might be electrotherapy important to improve the pain in this situation, okay, and help the patient to do the exercise and to assume active lifestyle. Grade B recommendation, again, as you can see, education is still very important. The best player here in the whiplash is education. Combined exercise, as we said, active cervical range of motion, isometric low load strengthening plus manual therapy. So still here we can do some cervical mobilization and manipulation, but very important for doing cervical manipulation to do thorough examination, vertebrobasilar insufficiency and instability test. And here we can use physical agents like ice, heat, and tennis. Okay, so what we call here is multimodal therapy. So we can use electrophysical therapy, we can use some manual therapy, and the most important cell here is the supervised exercise. Okay, active cervical range of motion, stretching, strengthening, endurance, and neuromuscular exercise, including postural coordination and stabilization elements. With all the tools that we have as physical therapists, all the new tools are being developed. The market is very full with instruments and tools that we think that we need to learn to improve ourselves. But I think the most important thing about cervical spine, we need to do the exercise for our patient. Teach the patient the exercise, spend more time in education and in doing exercise. Thirdly, might be manual therapy techniques. Okay, manual therapy techniques, we don't need to know too much. Okay, most of the time that what we know right now is quite good enough. Again, as C for chronic stage, as a grade C, there is no grade A and B recommendations. Okay, most of the recommendations are not that strong, but education still be very important. Cervical mobilization plus individualized progressive exercise, low-load cervical scapulothoracic flexibility, coordination. Vestibular rehabilitation, okay, all this recommended in the chronic stage. And some electrophysical agents can show to be beneficial. All right, as you can see, to summarize, whiplash, education always important. Exercise can be very important, all right. Some manual therapy, especially mobilization, can be useful. Can be multimodal, we can use electrophysical agent. So electrophysical agent show to be beneficial. And some mixed thing of all type of exercise, including strengthening exercise, endurance exercise, and proprioception exercise can be useful for those patients. We need to ask the patient to be patient because the treatment time will take like at least 3 months. And the improvement will be gradual, but there will be improvement at the end. And again, if you look for the prognosis, most of the improvement will occur in the first months. This is why early intervention, early physical therapy intervention is recommended. Since the time of the trauma, after the clearance of concussion, the 5Ds, red flags, they need to be referred as soon as physical therapy. So we need to start our treatment earlier. The third category is neck pain with headache, cervicogenic headache. So most of the condition, it is here, C2, C3, zygophysial joint, okay? C1, C2. And some of the new literature suggests C2, C3 as a source of the cervicogenic headache. So basically, this is a special category with neck pain with mobility deficits, you can say, occurring in the C1, C2. So 15 to 20% of the headaches, cervicogenic headache, is not uncommon. So it's very quite common. You will see a lot of people, especially people with rotated posture, they will have cervicogenic headache. It's non-continuous, okay, very important to understand, differentiate between cervicogenic headache and non-cervicogenic headache, other type of headaches. It's unilateral headache pain and associated referred headache. So usually this pain, this headache increase with neck pain. Okay, they are accompanied. If you increase the neck pain, the headache will increase. Okay, it is non-continuous. Okay, it comes sometimes during the day, and sometimes there's unilateral neck pain. Headache is precipitated by or aggravated by neck movement or sustained position or posture. So very important question about the headache for our patient. Does it change by your movement? Does it change by certain posture? Does it is it associated with neck movement and neck pain? So this is how we can say this is can be or there's high chance to have cervicogenic headache. Physical examination. According to scientific evidence, okay, the most important examination for those patients is active range of motion. We'll see there's a restriction, especially in the rotation, because most of the cervical rotation occur upper cervical segments. CO to C3, passive accessory intervertebral movement, that will show there is decreased mobility in this segment. And one of the physical examination that showed to be sensitive, valid, reliable cervical flexion rotation test. So this is where we do flexion and we do rotation for cervical spine, okay? If there is less than 45 degrees, okay, the patient, they might have cervicogenic headache, okay? So the limitation in the cervical rotation, this is why it's called cervical flexion rotation test, okay? And the way we're doing flexion to limit other movement, okay? It's sure to be significant, reliable and valid. So to diagnose cervicogenic headache, we need to look for subjective. We need to look for restriction, active range of motion, passive accessory intervertebral motion, and cervical flexion rotation test. And again, you need to look for neck flexors, and especially the upper segments, they will have endurance. So part of the training of the patients with cervicogenic headache, we need to include strength, endurance, and coordination and postural control. Acute stage, there's a grade B recommendation of supervised instruction in active mobility test for acute stage. And there's a grade C, okay? Recommendation is C1 to self-snack, okay? This is Mulligan concept, okay? So according to scientific evidence in cervical spine, the only technique, okay? There is no much literature talking about Mulligan concept in the cervical spine, okay? But this cervicogenic headache showed C1-2 surface snag is recommended. But better to have instructions to have active mobility test. So the patient need to continue to move. They can do cervical range motion, other type of exercise. As manual therapy, manipulation, thoracic spine manipulation is not recommended. Only manual therapy recommended here is C1-2 surface snag. For grade B recommendation, we can do cervical mobilization and manipulation. And still, C1-2 surface snag showed to be useful. Actually, this was depending on an Australian study. Interestingly, the surface snag showed relief symptoms even after 12 months of that treatment. So this was a randomized control trial. For chronic stage, cervicothoracic manipulation. So here in the chronic, we might need to include cervical upper thoracic manipulation. We might include cervical manipulation, shoulder girdle and neck stretching, strengthening and endurance exercise. So this is for chronic conditions. The last category is neck pain with radiating pain, radiculopathy. There's stenosis, nerve impingement, nerve root, decrease in the exit of the neural canal, etc., where there will be a neurological ailment. So a neck pain with radiating pain, a nerve band flaccidating pain in the involved extremity, upper extremity dermatomal paresthesia, numbness, and myotomal muscle weakness. So if we have any weakness, myotomal, dermatomal reflexes that work with the dermatomes, we need to suspect cervical radiculopathy. Okay, physical impairment measure. So we talked about Sperling test. As you can see, sensitivity 0.5, specificity 0.86 to 93. Still sensitivity is very low for Sperling. Traction, neck distraction, sensitivity is about 0.44. A neurodynamic 0.72, sensitivity between 0.17 to 0.78. So all these are very low sensitivity. So how to diagnose cervical radiculopathy? There is a cluster, okay? The cluster, we need to measure Sperling test, traction, distraction, and neurodynamic test one, and cervical range of motion. So for four tests, we need to measure to make sure the patient have cervical radiculopathy. If the patient have one positive out of four, we will not say this patient have cervical radiculopathy. If the patient has three or four out of four, there's high chance for this patient to have cervical radiculopathy. For cervical radiculopathy, we need to involve exercise, okay? We might have a short-term collar use, okay? Short-term, will not include 3 days. Mobilizing and stabilizing element, like scapulothoracic, cervical range of motion. One electrophysical agent showed to be useful. There's literature about low-level laser, acute stage, which can be useful. There is no enough studies talking about subacute radiculopathy, okay? The guidelines didn't show any findings, and this might be the assignment of the researchers to look for the possible treatment for patients with subacute stage. For chronic, okay, the best, there's a combo treatment that's suggested by many studies, okay? We need to use intermittent cervical traction, okay? As we know, like lumbar traction has shown not to be useful for lumbar patient or lumbar radiculopathy or any lumbar case. But there's scientific evidence, enough scientific evidence to use intermittent cervical traction for patient with chronic radiculopathy. But this is not enough unless it was included by with stretching and strength exercise. We can include cervical and thoracic mobilization and manipulation, okay? So if you just can do manipulation for thoracic spine rather than manipulation for cervical, because even for this condition, cervical manipulation might be, you need to be very careful about it. So you just can do thoracic manipulation, intermittent cervical traction, and teach the patient how to do stretching and strength exercise, okay? Again, we talk about a chronic situation. We need to think about always about counseling and education and participation in occupational and exercise activity. We need for those patients to go back to their life as soon as possible. Okay, a very important approach for us is McKinsey approach, okay? Most of the patients, most physical therapists, we like to use McKinsey. We tried it many times for lumbar patients, sometimes like a magic. And there is a huge evidence about McKinsey approach for treatment of lumbar radiculopathy, okay? But for cervical spine, we'll not say it's not recommended. We'll say there's limited studies including cervical spine. Sometimes when we talk about there is no evidence, sometimes there is lack of evidence. Okay, the technique was not examined properly or enough way to conclude its effectiveness. So we do like retraction 15 times, the supine extension in the edge of the table, then progress to sitting, whatever. In high quality systematic review, McKinsey approach was as effective as wait and see approach in a wide variety of neck pain times. So wait and see, you are not doing nothing. So in high quality systematic review, McKinsey approach for the cervical spine was equal in benefit to wait and see approach. Okay, and this is not very old, it's about Kasaki and May 2014. But most of the authors, even for the systematic review, they recommend they need to have more high quality evidence looking for McKinsey approach. Okay, I know this can be depressing for some of you who like McKinsey approach too much. Okay, so these are the references. It was taken from the APTA guidelines, which is can find it in the APTA website. Which is can say clinical practice guidelines. It's very useful guidelines for many musculoskeletal conditions, including low back pain, heel pain, knee pain, and shoulder pain. So you just can find many clinical guidelines. I always suggest these guidelines because it was a huge work for many scientists, many authors, who look for the scientific evidence in examination and treatment. And there are many other studies that was included, especially the newer edition from after 2016. And I would like to thank you all for attending this webinar. I just want to receive any question through the chat, please. Okay, I have 4 questions right now. The first question. Okay. Can neck pain be considered referral pain? What would it be? And could it be caused by stress, anxiety, or disturbed psychological status? If so, it is possible for the pain to persist after the improvement of the psychological state. Okay, this is a very, very good question. Yes, it can be referred pain. As shoulder pain, this sometimes can be referral shoulder pain to the neck pain. Yes, it can be referral. Even if the psychological state can improve, there will be mechanical, there will be biological. We talk about biopsychosocial, so we need to have good 3 elements, social, psychological, and biological. Okay, some of the patient persists because of the cortical sensitivity, higher emotional status, mental symptoms, anxiety, distress. Some of the patient pain persists because of their bad posture and poor lifestyle. Some of the patient because of their biological system. Okay, so we can't say the patient will improve until we have full recovery of the biopsychosocial system. How we deal with somatic pain affecting the cervical spine? Thank you. Can we get the video? السوماتيك هو حكينا في نيوترينت كل الفيزيكال ثيرابي اللي هو المالتي ديسيبلينري. اوكي احنا كفيزيكال ثيرابيست مش ترين تو بي كونسلر. اوكي مش ترين تو بي كونسلر. وي كان ليرن اباوت سم كونسبتس لايك كوجنيتيف بيهيفيرال ثيرابي. وي هاف سترونج تول وات ويل بي جود سايكولوجيكال تولز ايدوكيشن. معظم المرضى بيخافوا من ال بيصيرون بخوف بسبب عدم المعرفه. اوكي المعرفه سلاح. صار عندنا معرفه للبيشنت علمناهم كويس وعلمناهم شو مشكلتهم وكيف يتعاملوا مع مشكلتهم حيرتاح. اغلب المرضى بيعانوا من عدم فهمهم للامور. للاسف يعني from different healthcare providers they didn't give enough information about patient's condition. There's an Arabic form, yes. The Arabic form of the neck disability index موجودة ومترجمة باللغة العربية و valid or reliable translated. خلينا نشوف, of course. Can you explain to us how the thoracic manipulation was an A, B evidence? بالأغلب ما فيش عندنا grade A evidence, grade B كان متنوع حسب ال condition. بس thoracic manipulation معظم الحالات هو showed to be very good option for treatment of cervical spine. That internal organ have an effect on the neck. Okay, هلا احنا جزء من ال اهتمام حاول دوم الميز بين شغلتين بالسيرة البين سيرة البين ونن في سيرة البين أو ميكانيكال بين. هلأ الكليم إنه مثلا ناس أنت ببتك ألسر بتعمل ليميتيشن برينج اوف موشن، هذا الكليم ما فيش عليه دليل علمي. يعني خلينا نكون واضحين فيها لتصبي أنس أوستيوباتيك بالسيرة المانيبوليشن doesn't have any scientific evidence. Just to be honest with this. As you can see, this is guidelines developed from different, from multiple experts in physical therapy, revised the scientific evidence. It's well known that visceral manipulation doesn't have any scientific evidence. It's based on some techniques that other non-physical therapy do. It is possible that internal organ have an effect. Okay, which is better, the cold bags or hot bags for neck pain? بالغالب, we talk about the acute. Okay, acute, subacute. We know that acute we use cold bags, and subacute and chronic we prefer hot bags. Okay, so I don't talk about about Mulligan. In my opinion, I'm certified Mulligan practitioner. My opinion doesn't count as important, really. Okay, never look to the person who's giving the opinion. Look for the scientific evidence. The most important is to talk about the scientific evidence. My opinion doesn't count. All right. Talking about scientific evidence, there is evidence about C1, C2 self-snag in treatment of the acute subacute cervicogenic headache. Okay, that's all what we know about Mulligan approach in the cervical. But just to be fair with Mulligan approach, I still prefer, as I said in this lecture, the most important is exercise. The most important is education. Rather than learning new skills, we need to master our current skills of exercise and education. Okay. Don't look for any expert opinion or any opinion, look for the scientific evidence. So as C1, C2, self-snag, we respect Mulligan approach, which has well-developed scientific evidence. The problem with Mulligan now, there is no enough research. Let me be honest with that, okay? So we strict with what we have as evidence, okay? Do what has been shown to be, have strong scientific evidence. If you want to apply more, why not, okay? So if you are, as chronic radiculopathy, if you just do intermittent traction, you teach the patient exercise, you do cervical thoracic manipulation, want to do extra Mulligan approach, I will not say this is the wrong approach, okay? But even though I'm saying this is the combination, all patients are different. Some patients, they might need to apply electrotherapy. Some patients, they may have benefited from something else. Can pillow changes be beneficial for pain management? I don't think so, okay? Few recommendation, you know, they haven't put in a good alignment to cervical spine. Like in hell, the pillow optimal neck pain, I don't think so. Which better to do firstly for decrease range of motion, stitch or string? يعني دائما هو النظام نحسن الرينج اوف موشن وبنحسن الفلكسبيليتي بعدين السترينث بعدين الانديورنس بعدين البروبرسبشن. هيك النظام بيمشي. يعني اول ما بعلم مريض بعلم رينج اوف موشن ستريتشنج سترينثنينج انديورنس بعدين البروبرسبشن. If the patient has fibromyalgia from neck pain, how does this affect my treatment plan? Okay, fibromyalgia is becoming a hotspot now, say the corona. Fibromyalgia, they might include cortical sensitivity, okay? Cortical sensitivity, you might need to include aerobic exercise. You need to hit heavily on the psychological elements, emotional status, anxiety, depression, fear avoidance, catastrophization. Okay, including the biological treatment. So talking about fibromyalgia with neck pain, aerobic exercise sure to have some good evidence. As you know, fibromyalgia always recommended to do swimming. Still, I think it's good. What's the best practice when treating neck pain, pain-free or no pain, no gain? Okay, very interesting question. Looking from perspective of Mulligan, okay, and no pain, and looking for the new treatment that we need to always to see the irritability, okay. Usually the vigorous exercise that can increase reflex muscle spasm and can worsen the condition and can increase the patient fear of movement. Okay, so we need to always to assure the patient that they can move in the right way. So no pain, no gain is not recommended anymore. Okay, no one of the categories that we said previously. Thank you all. Is there any evidence for myofascial release in chronic neck pain? No at all. Okay. Myofascial release, there is no suggestion of any beneficial effect of myofascial release.
Thank you, Dr. Saddam, for this amazing lecture. Thank you, attendees, for attending the lecture. Again, this is Dr. Saddam's email. And please stay tuned for other webinars in the series in platform, in the Maharat platform. So thank you and come again, please.
Thank you.